sickness and everybody has a remedy? Have you ever been around situations where everybody knows how to take care of your disease? And sometimes the disease is when the remedy can be worse than the disease. Everybody has advice. But not all advice is God-given advice. You understand that? You got all these compadres and comadres, you got all these friends, and listen, if they do not walk with God, they may have good common sense advice, but you want to go a little beyond that. You want to go to spiritual advice. Amen?
Amen.
A lot of people have good advice, but what does God say? So I would say to us, receive the encouragement and the direction. Notice again, be strong and do the work. The Bible said David gave the plans, those plans that David gave to his son, he had received from God. For in verse 19 it says, and this I hear from the hand of the Lord, he gave me understanding. So I have a phrase in this of one, words have power. Would you agree with me that words have power? The Bible says in Proverbs 18:21 that the tongue has the power of life and death. The tongue has the power of life and death. You can edify or you can assassinate with your tongue. Yes or no?
Amen.
Now, I did a little research on this and I discovered that women speak an average of 20,000 words a day or more. Men speak 7,000 words or less. Now there's a big difference between 20,000 and 7,000, right?
Amen.
One of the biggest complaints, among other things, that women have is, Pastor, he won't talk to me. Well, sweetheart, he's used up his 7,000 words. He's been at work. And he's used up his 7,000 words, and you have to pry things out of him. The best way to get a man to talk is just kind of warm up to him. Don't be a drill sergeant telling him what to do. Don't be an investigator, finding out what he's been up to. Just be a friend. Just try near to the person. There's a big difference between 20,000 and 7,000. Now, you can use those excessive words to build up or to tear down. Many times men have complained that they feel like they're not good daddies because the mom's always reminding him, or the wife's always reminding him of the bad things he's done, the mistakes he's made. You weren't there for your kids. You're always too busy for the children. Well, if you would just purpose as husband and wife to be a one flesh ministry, do it together. And if you understand his weaknesses, compliment him. And if you understand her weaknesses, compliment her. It's a team. We're not to be competing or conflicting. We're supposed to be helping one another, amen?
Amen.
And if the guy doesn't open up, and you've got all kinds of things to say, say it, but say it right. The idea is that you can say the right thing, say it the right way, say it at the right time, and say it in the right place, amen? And always be aware that your little ones' antennas are up. They don't want to hear you humiliating daddy. They don't want to see you bad-mouthing, defaming the man in their lives. So be very, very careful. Let's encourage one another. And you know, if you're married to a drill sergeant, pray for her that God will change her heart or change her home. Some of you missed those words. But you know what? We've got to say false. I mean, sometimes we use our mouth to bad mouth instead of encourage one another. We're not to be dictators. We're to be helpers. Encourage and provide direction. Be strong. Do the good work. Do the good work that the Lord has given you to do. And if we can do it again, more encouragement is needed. Encourage it. And in verses 20 to 21, if you'll jump down to 20-21, look what he says. Be strong. Be strong. What else? Be courageous. Why? Because the task is big. What else? For the Lord God is with you. Who is with you? Amen. Listen. God is with you. Don't ever feel like you're by yourself. God is with you. So be strong. Be courageous, right out of the Bible. The Lord is with you, and He will not fail you. We fail one another. Pastors fail congregations. Congregations fail pastors. But our God will never fail us. Amen. He will never fail you, and He will not forsake you. He will not. He'll never turn His back. Listen, if you have been the victim of someone walking out on you, learn from that mistake. Learn from those bad decisions. But be encouraged by the fact that God will never, ever forsake you. Now you must know this. You are immortal until all the work for the service of God, of the temple of God, is finished. Now what does this mean? Look, I want you to think about this statement. You're not going to die until God says so.
Amen.
You're not. Amen. I don't care what the doctor says. Now you just need to be busy about building the temple. And the things of God. You'll be busy, working about the Lord. First, acknowledge Him, serve Him, do it with a glad heart, a perfect heart, do it with a willing spirit. And I guarantee you, you will not die until God says that you're ready to go. Now, Pastor, what if my husband dies 2 weeks from now? I was finished. Don't come in with a lawsuit against White Avenue Baptist Church. God was finished with her. God was finished with her. If I drop dead tomorrow, God was finished with me. I don't worry about when I'm going to die. You cannot worry when you're going to die. It's for sure you're going to die. But it's going to happen. Just relax and just live your life with His glory. Celebrate the memories of those that have left us. But just today, just say I am alive today because God has purchased me alive. You know, we think of all the wonderful people that have gone before us, dads, moms, wives, husbands, and we say, thank you, God, for them. But you're still alive, and you're alive on purpose. So you're immortal until God says. Now, let me conclude with this. Spiritual leaders must be ready. Spiritual leaders must be ready. Notice, verse 21, the priest and the Levites are ready. I don't think I gave you that, but verse 21. Spiritual leaders, pastors, we need to be ready. Number two, spiritual men must man up. Every willing man will help. Now he's talking to Solomon, right? See, Solomon, you've got spiritual leaders that are going to be there for you. They're ready. Solomon, you got spiritual men that are going to walk with you. You're not going to face it alone. And then Solomon's spiritual members must walk the talk. The officials. All the people will obey. You know what this says? It covers all the bases. Spiritual leaders, men, the church, all the bases are covered. The devil wants you to focus on the bad, but God invites you to focus on the good. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly. This is 1 Chronicles 21, 29, 10 through 13. Man, when you get a chance, don't have time right now, but when you get a chance, you have to spend time reading Psalms, 1 Chronicles 29. And he just spent time. This is what David was able to dance in the presence of God. He just spent time praising God instead of giving the devil all the credit. Here's the father's legacy. The father's legacy. This is how his story ends. David's story. The Bible says that David ruled over Israel 40 years. And he died. But notice how he died. And this is how I want to die. He died at a good old age. You know what that means? It was a good, that means he was old. But he didn't die like a grumpy old man. He didn't die a complaining old man. He died at a good old age. That was he was probably good to be around. Instead of people avoiding him, he was good, a good old age. Having enjoyed a long life. Someone said it's not how many years your life has, but how much life your years have. He died to have an enjoyed life. Let me ask you a question. Are you enjoying life? Or are you enduring your days? Enjoyment. See, if you can enjoy life, it's a praise unto God. But if you go through life just enduring life, it's a discredit to the church of God. Because you'll be prone to murmur and blame. Nobody wants what you have if you're a pessimist or a negative. But if you go through life enjoying long life, guess what? People are going to ask, what is that about you? You can tell them about Jesus. He died with wealth and honor. Wealth and honor. Now, that wealth doesn't have to do with riches and gold or silver and gold. It could be. Could be that God will trust you with rich silver and gold. Could be. But it could be maybe just things that just emotional well-being and healthy body. I don't know. Wealthy. Wealth and honor. And to be honored means that you have a good reputation. And the kids could say, you know what? The God of my daddy, the God of my mommy, the God of my grandparents, I want that. I'll ask this question as I promise I'm landing the baby now, okay? Do any of you remember your great-grandparents? Could you tell me your great-grandparents' names? Maybe a small percentage of you could. Great, my grandparents, but great-grandparents. What about your great-great-grandparents? Could you know? Do you know? Think about that. Oh, we may know their country of origin, we may know some, but can you remember their names? Can you remember anything significant that your great-grandparents contributed in your life? But this is where I'm going. Just like you cannot remember your great-grandparents' names and maybe something significant they contributed in your life, your great-grandkids, likewise. Unless you're intentional. Unless you're intentional. Unless you're really purpose to invest in their lives. I've got 6 grandkids. And I want to see them grow up. And I just want to be able to be there for them. And I want them to be there when I put on my hair and head, when I lose all my teeth, when they have to push me around. I want to be there. I want to be able to love on them. Amen. To encourage them. So they can feel the security of their love. Amen. Daddies, happy Father's Day. He loves you very much. And a plan and a purpose for you. Father in heaven, I want to thank you for every person in this place today. Thank you for caring for us. Thank you. We have a book known as the Holy Bible that we can study. Thank you that when you created us, you didn't leave us to ourselves, but you gave us a manual for successful living. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you that we could open that book and have you speak to us. Help us. With every head bowed and every eye closed, I wonder if there's any person in this place that would say today, you know what? I really want a relationship with God. I want to get to know God like some people that I've known. I want to feel forgiven, and I want to know that when I die, I'm going to go to heaven. Maybe that's you. Let me tell you how you can do it. All it takes is for you to admit a couple of things. First of all, that you are a sinner. We make mistakes. We sin against God. And number two, you're not going to find forgiveness anywhere else apart from Jesus Christ. So what do you have to do? Just say to God, right there where you are, you can say to God, God, I really want you to forgive me. I've blown it. I've made a bunch of mistakes. God, would you forgive me my sins? And this God is not mad at you. He loves you. Now say to Jesus, Lord Jesus, if you're the only Savior of the world, would you come into my heart today? I want to start a brand new life. I really do. If it is true that you honor my faith more than my faults, I want to have put my faith in you right now. Even if I don't understand a lot of stuff, I want to trust you. Say to Jesus, Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save me. Now, before we conclude this prayer, let me ask you a question. If you pray that prayer, and if that expresses the desire of your heart, would you let me know who you are? I just want to pray for you and thank God for you. If you ask God to forgive you and Jesus to come into your heart this morning, would you raise your hand quickly so I can thank God for you? Just raise your hand high, and then I'll thank God for you. Amen.